This is the University of Sheffield's Advanced Manufacturing Research Centre, and I'm here at the Factory of the Future to see exactly what Castrol has in store for us. They are talking about this as being the next generation in fluid management, and so I'm really excited to see what they have in store for us.
The University of Sheffield's Advanced Manufacturing Research Centre, or the AMRC, was founded in 2001 out of a unique partnership between the University of Sheffield and the aerospace giant Boeing. The vision was to bridge the gap between university research and the needs of global manufacturing, and that's grown into a network of industrial partners, including the likes of Rolls-Royce, McLaren, and Airbus.
Now this is what Castrol wanted to show me. This is called the SmartCoolant Device, and it basically takes all the different aspects of coolant management and fits it into a single box. So that includes measurement of coolant, as well as dosing of coolant, as well as monitoring of coolant, all in a single box. Now, the reason why I find this really interesting is because a couple of years ago, you might have, or might not have seen a video on this channel where I talked about the idea of subscribing to lubricants. And the idea would be that no matter how much lubricant you use, you would pay effectively a monthly fee. Now, there were some boundaries to that. Number one, yeah, how do you charge and all that sort of stuff. But ultimately, where I thought this was going is a complete service solution. So the idea that, for example, in regular lubricants, in industrial, you could do both provision of the lubricants, as well as filtration, as well as top-ups, as well as oil analysis, all under a single contract and a single price. And that this basically is one of the first implementations of that kind of system, except that instead of for industrial lubricants, we're doing it for industrial coolants.
Now, I'm no machining expert, so I turned to a real expert to explain how coolants can affect machine tool life and the surface finish of the piece.
Right, yeah. So, I mean, we want to keep the coolant in a fit condition, so it affects the tool life and it affects the surface finish on the component. So when we're in production and we need consistent, accurate parts, then a good quality machine tool, cutting tools, good quality, coolant, a good quality and well managed, so we don't wear the tools out and we can hit the tolerances that we need to. And from another point of view, the operator's health and the people actually working in the cell around them. So, you know, dermatitis can be a problem, and the respiratory problems that people can get from the cutting with the coolants, and so we need good filtration. So all this helps when you've got good coolant management, because you keep a consistent level and then everything's well controlled and you're not putting extra variables into the process. Yeah, so when we're manufacturing high tolerance, high accuracy components, we can lose the dimensional tolerance on the component simply by the coolant being out of spec, and therefore the cutting tools wearing more and they can push off more. We can get heat build up, and so all these factors will start to affect the tolerances on the components that we're making. You can also suffer from tramp oil from the slideways of the machines getting into the coolant, and when that happens, the lubricity changes, and of course then you start getting different surface finishes, and of course the wear of your cutting tools change as well.
So this here is the brains of the machine. So on this control panel, you're going to get all of the key information about, let's say for example, coolant concentration. What's the actual level of coolant that's in the tank? What's the temperature that it's running at? And we can go through and change a bunch of settings. Now, coolant concentration is an interesting one. The set point here is that they are aiming to dose at 8%. And here, you can see that the concentration is 8.01%. And that's a level of precision that you just don't see in this kind of manufacturing. You know, typically people are measuring coolant concentration maybe once a week or once a month, and you get a decent amount of variation. In fact, here on the actual plate of this particular machine, it's saying that coolant concentration should be anywhere between about 6 and 8%. So, you know, in relative terms, that's a 30% swing in coolant concentration. So for us to be able to dial it in, oh, it's just gone to 8.00, 7.99, that's a high level of precision. You know, and frankly, that level of precision is what's missing when it comes to machining. you know, machining is such a high precision. I mean, this facility itself does machining of a lot of aerospace components. We know how precise that can be, and yet our coolant concentrations can be out by something like 30% at sometimes. That doesn't make a whole lot of sense. So this level of precision is awesome. Off and see what's underneath. So this is the smarts of the machine. You've got oil flow coming in, which is confirmed by a pressure sensor. It's going through to here, which is the refractometer. Now, refractometer is used to measure coolant concentration inside of the coolant system. Now, we've always done this, right? That bit's not new. We've always done it either by an analog refractometer or a digital one. The challenge in making this an inline sensor and having it read in real time has always been the cleanliness of the refractometer. So what is unique about this one is that it is self kind of calibrating or self cleaning. So what it does is it shoots a small jet of water through, and that should read coolant concentration zero because it's pure water. If it doesn't read zero, it knows that there's something wrong. It cleans the refractometer window, re-baselines it, and then gets a more accurate reading. So that is one of the absolute keys, is to getting accurate coolant concentration. Over there, there's actually a gap. That's where we would put a conductivity sensor if it's needed. Now, conductivity is key for measuring hardness. So if you're constantly topping up with tap water, for example, the minerals will stay behind while the water evaporates, and that can cause a buildup of hardness over time. This one here, this is your pH sensor. pH is obviously crucial inside of coolants and metalworking fluids because alterations in the pH can leave you susceptible to bacterial growth, which causes all sorts of issues. And then finally, we've got flow as well as a pressure sensor for the system to go out. Now over here, what we've actually got an inlet for the dosing system. So that's what's giving us coolant, which is pumped from the drum behind me, right? So that's being pumped into the system in very, very small doses to keep the coolant concentration at a very precise level. Now over here, we've actually got some tank gauges. So this here is a digital gauge, which is going to give us the level of the coolant inside of the tank. That's obviously really important to know because we need to know how much to fill with. But there is redundancy, which is built in, which I think is really good. So there's actually mechanical redundancy. So over here, you can see where the sensor would go. This is actually a physical sensor. So this would go underneath there, and it's a physical plumb bob. So when this reaches its end point, you would say the tank is at danger of being overfilled and it will shut down the system. So you've got that sort of dual redundancy built in for accuracy and then for safety. So this is the dashboard, which would be accessible via, you know, computer interface. I guess it's all connected up, right, via the cloud. Now, you can imagine, for example, that this might be housed in a central control room where, like, an operator could then view or get a dashboard view of all of the different machines that are currently operating. So that smart box, for example, is able to connect basically up to 10 different machines. And so you could have, like, a centralized console where there might be, say, 10 different machines here, all with, you know, varying degrees of status, right? So green light, yellow light, red light, as an example. And of course, right, everyone wants more data, right? So here is an example. I don't know if you can see it on the screen here, but concentration, pH value, the tank level, you've got your conductivity. Remember, that's an optional sensor, as well as your temperature and your, you know, how filled is the concentrate, as well as how much water have you used. So all of this information would be available basically at the click of a button. Now, with AI coming on board, right? Everyone wants to get on board with AI and they want to do all this machine learning stuff. It all starts with high quality data, right? And if you're taking tank readings or if you're taking coolant concentrations once a week or once a month, that's not enough to build up a robust data set. So having something like this where you're measuring, you know, either a minute by minute or hour by hour basis, that's giving you that quality data, which you can then use to then further improve your manufacturing efforts. So this, I think, is actually going to be a bit of a game changer in just in terms of how much data is being generated, but on top of that, all the analytics that you can do on the back end as well. So here, for example, this is showing you in real time the concentration, right, of the coolant. And you can see here, like, it's fairly obvious here that the target is this 8% line, and you've got your yellow bar. So if you ever think about used oil analysis, you've got your sort of like your caution as well as your alarm limits. That's exactly what this dotted yellow line and dotted red line is. The idea is that the smart coolant system, if you get any deviations beyond here because I don't know, maybe it's we've got a hose leak or something like that, it's going to give you a notification in real time, you know, either send you a text message or send you an email or something like that, so that we can intervene really quickly. And again, this is one of the reasons why I've been on about, you know, these real-time monitoring solutions, is because you can get that sort of real-time feedback. Okay, so here we've got real-time consumption of concentrate as well as consumption of water. And we might want to use this data, for example, to optimize our manufacturing process. So let's say, for example, we might look at how much concentrate is consumed per machine part that is manufactured. Or we might find that there are certain machine parts, cast iron is kind of well known for this, that consume more concentrate. Then as a manufacturer, maybe I then say, well, if I'm consuming more concentrate per unit part, maybe I'm going to pass on some of that cost to the customer because manufacturing cost is higher. So being able to have, again, this level of data really helps us when it comes to manufacturing processes, but as well as productivity. All right, now that I've seen the system in action, some initial thoughts. My initial thoughts are, this is really exciting. This is an antidote to the commoditization of our business that has been occurring over the last decade or so, where, you know, entrants fight on a dollar per liter basis. This is bringing solutions which are actually valuable to the end user. So that I really, really like. It's a coalescing of a whole bunch of different themes that I've been talking about. It's high quality data that's delivered on a routine basis, which can actually then be used to optimize the process, right? That's always been a challenge with laboratory oil analysis, which still has its place and is still useful. But when you're testing once every 3 to 6 months, that's not, you know, regular enough data. And in an age where everyone's talking about machine learning and AI, we need very dense, repeatable data sets. It's about the lubricant management, right? If we were talking about, you know, industrial kind of lubricants, I'd probably start talking about filtration at this point. But here we're talking about the microdosing, right? And getting that dose precise. And so all of these things coming together, that is what makes, I think, this really special. And it speaks to, I think it has a really, really strong future. Now, Castrol have talked about what are the potential future developments of this system. And it's making it more modular. It's being able to connect it to more systems. It's being able to then take that data and run it through machine learning models to optimize the process. So all of that can be enabled by the technology that we've just seen here.